interviews met oprichter Mark Knopfler.
Piano when I was about 9 months, nine years old, and that changed everything. Because when I first heard boogie, maybe it was six or nine. I don't know if I remember nine. Because it was the first time I'd heard that music, and the three chords were so beautiful to me, and the whole thing was so logical to me. These, you know, big sort of blocks sailed into place, you know, this is for me. That's kind of like that, and I wanted a guitar from when I was very small. I remember seeing one picture in the back of a magazine, and my father, I said, I want that, you know, a little picture of one, I want that. I wanted it and all the way through until I was about 15.
You know, about the age of the time I was going to the Spanish City and stuff, all I wanted was a red electric guitar. And the only reason I wanted a red electric guitar was because it was the sound made by one of my old-time favorite guitar players. And I still wish I could get a guitar to sound the way he gets it to sound. And he actually recorded this tune, so he knows it. So here he is, one of the old-time favorites, the man himself, Hank B. Marvin.
Hank B. Marvin was begin jaren 60 als gitarist van Cliff Richards' begeleidingsgroep The Shadows held en voorbeeld voor ieder jongen die gitaar wilde spelen.
Had to be left. I didn't have the nerve. It cost my dad about 50 quid, which was a lot of money for him, you know. But I pestered him so much, you know, and I didn't have the nerve to ask for an amplifier, you know, because I'd spend all this money on the guitar. I used to borrow a friend's acoustic guitar to play in folk joints, and I did everything. I learned to fingerstyle, and I was also playing electric guitar, borrowing amplifiers, playing in bands, and all kinds of stuff. So I was progressing on a number of fronts, you know, with acoustic music and electric music. My guitar, and I went to a friend's place. He also played, and he had B.B. King live at the Regal, and it was a revelation to me to relate. There's a triangle between the voice, the guitar, and the audience, and there's a real drama where the voice would say something, the audience would fire back, the guitar would play, the audience would fire back. And he's playing and singing, and there's a real audience participation and reaction, and it's all a flow.
Thank you!
Well, I heard James Burton. A friend has had his big sister had a record playing, you know, was jiving around, and I was listening to her Ricky Nelson records, and James Burton was playing on there. Things like Just a Little Too Much and Hello Mary Lou and stuff like that. And Elvis and all the Scotty Moore stuff on the Elvis records. And the Everly Brothers have very big influence because the... And I didn't know then that it was Chet who was playing the electric guitar parts on all the Everly Brothers records. Buddy Holly.
And the person that I admire an awful lot
very famous guitarist of Dire Straits. Writes all their tunes and sings all the songs. I love him as a musician and as a person, Mark Knopfler. Mark, I think I know the answer to this question, but I'll ask you anyway. Would you rather play guitar or sing?
Well, Chet, you know, when you're in the presence of the world's number one guitar player, you just rather pick and learn.
Just like I wrote it. Well, if you will sing us one of your hits, then we'll play a couple more tunes.
Well, let's play it first. Let's play it first, and then...
Oh, we're going to play it first. Okay. I'll see you in my dream.
Okay. Right.
I think Bob Dylan was probably the biggest influence from his very first album. And musically, too, in a way.
Well, I'm just an aging drummer boy, but in the wars I used to play. Called a tune to make it all just say I am a war criminal, and I'm fading away. While the peace in my country. And I can still hear his song. And then she's there, yeah, and then she's gone.
My first job really was as a newspaper reporter for the Yorkshire Evening Post in Leeds, and it was a big regional newspaper, and that was the last story that I ever did. I was leaving to go to university, and the last story on my last day, I was sitting in Leeds Town Hall wondering, because I'd been covering courts that day, and I was wondering what I was going to say to everybody, because there was going to be some presentation, they were going to give me a cigarette lighter or something, and goodbye. And I was just thinking, what am I going to say to everybody? And then the phone rang, and picked it up, press room, and it was the news editor, and he said, Mark, he said, Jimmy Anderson, or whatever he's called, did you know him? He's dead, lad. And I go, oh, God. Are you there? Yeah. Well, I'm putting you straight onto copy. Write a few words about it, you know. So I just put the phone down, and I just wrote a few quick words about Jimmy. Phoned it into copy, and... walked round to the office, said goodbye to everybody, got my cigarette lighter, and went and got drunk. Went to university, and that was it. That was the last story that I did. It was the death of Jimi Hendrix. And pieces here and there, and John happened to be living in the same flat, and I just thought it was an instant band possible, and we got a drummer, and we started rehearsing, and it all worked out really well.
De melodieuze muziek van Dire Straits wordt gekenmerkt door het sprankelende gitaarspel van Mark Knopfler. Tussen het agressieve en ruige punkgeluid vormt Dire Straits eind jaren 70 een oase van muzikaliteit. Het succes overvalt de groep, die moeite heeft zich aan de plotselinge roem aan te passen.
It was very difficult in the early stages. I mean, I remember in Holland, for instance, where we became successful first. I mean, the other countries followed just weeks later, days later, really. But Holland was the very first place that we came to do a bunch of interviews in Amsterdam. And I remember I did 12 interviews or something in one day, and I just remember lying on the bed at the end of it, thinking, well, I wonder if I'm going to die, you know.
Wegens meningsverschillen met broer Mark verlaat David Knopfler Dire Straits tijdens de opname voor de derde LP Making Movies. David gaat zich met produceren bezighouden en probeert enige tijd later een solo carrière van de grond te krijgen. Voor de promotie van Making Movies blijven 3 leden over.
What does the name actually mean, Dire Straits?
In the shit.
In the shit. Well, it tends to be associated with financial. It tends to be associated with financial problems, but. A desperate situation, really, is what it means. And that's a desperate situation in shit. Yeah.
I love struck Romeo, seen the streets of very new, laying everybody low, with a love song that he made. Playing in my heart, and I forget. The movie song. When is he gonna realize it was just that the time was wrong? Juliet.
I didn't used to get involved in videos at all, which was a big mistake. I used to think, oh yeah, man, let the filmmaker do his thing, you know. I'll do my thing, and the filmmaker, it doesn't work out that way. So by the time Money for Nothing came up, I'm a very slow learner, and I thought maybe I should get more involved in videos. So I started taking more of an interest, and because there were so many things that were made that I just thought I just couldn't watch them. Yeah, I thought they were terrible.
I've seen a girl on a one-way corridor, down a wrong way, and
but has there been a moment that maybe with a new amplifier, maybe a new guitar, you suddenly got this sound that you recognize as, hey, this is my sound? Yeah. Yeah, I was living on somebody's floor in London and trying to get a band together with some people, and I was playing a cheap Japanese acoustic on the floor, and it had very light strings on, like electric guitar strings, and I knew then that the whole style thing was just coming out really, really hard. That I was flying around on this guitar with my fingers, but that was the time. And I was just sitting on the floor with that thing, and I just remember thinking, "Geez, this is it. This is the way I play." I might have tried once or twice with an idea about that. I can't believe in it. It doesn't work out that way at all. You can, a lot of things, like this thing I'm just remixing is Twisting by the Pool. We recorded it in one day.
het werk van Knopfler wordt ook door collega's zeer gewaardeerd. Bob Dylan vraagt Mark om zijn LP Infidels te produceren, terwijl Tina Turner een belangrijke stap in haar comeback zet aan de hand van Mark's compositie Private Dancer.
I was going to do it. In fact, we demoed it for a Love Over Gold album, but it just didn't fit in with the other songs. We did it real different. I did it with brushes and it didn't leap in octaves the way Tina did it. But I wasn't at Tina's session. But for that song at all. Some of the guys in the band went and played on it.
Thank you. All right, everybody in. Drop it up.
Na Love Over Gold en Alchemy verschijnt in 1985 Brothers in Arms, de zesde en laatste LP van Dire Straits. Als ambassadeurs van een nieuw product, de Compact Disc, gaat de groep een jaar lang op tournee. In 25 landen worden bij elkaar meer dan 200 concerten gegeven. Genoeg om voorlopig niet meer bij elkaar te komen.
I'll always be touring, I guess. I'll always be out there playing. But the last tour was a year long. And just, you turn around and everything's changed. I mean, people are different. You get back home again and all kinds of things that happen. Too much. The whole thing about playing live is very important to me, but it's all got to be. Got to cool it a bit, really. We did hundreds and hundreds of shows. A lot of songs that I've written, I wouldn't write them now, obviously. You just, your interests change, you know, what you think is good changes, and a lot of the songs are just experiments, really. They're just experiments in doing a certain thing, and then you just get bored with it and you move on to something else. And you, hopefully you get better. I'm not sure whether you do.
Na So Far Away is Walk of Life de zesde en laatste hit van Dire Straits in ons land. Money for Nothing levert de groep begin 86 een Grammy op voor de beste videoclip van het voorgaande jaar. Mark Knopfler raakt meer en meer betrokken bij andermans werk. Hij produceert LP's van John Armatrading en Randy Newman. Verder legt hij zich toe op het componeren van filmmuziek. Na scores voor Local Hero en Cal schrijft hij in 88 de muziek voor The Princess Bride, met de daarbij behorende en door Willie DeVille gezongen filmclip Storybook Story.
It's brain damage as well. Well, I talked to Randy a lot about this. It's you like the idea at the beginning and then you get involved in it, and it's so difficult a lot of the time to get it to do it right. And you kind of, there are times when you ask yourself whether you need it. Do I need this answer? No. But you're still doing it. You're still involved in doing it. I don't know why. I think it's a challenge to you. To me, it's a challenge because I don't really know what the hell I'm doing. So I'm just amazed when it's finished. Mm-hmm. it's done. I can't believe it. And Princess Bride is 100 cues of music to do. Couldn't believe her how it got done. When I listened to it, I just can't believe how I did it.
And how he worshipped.
It's not difficult for me because I'm doing my favorite thing. So in a sense, it's compulsive. I mean, I'm not a maniac about it. You know, I'm lazy about writing. But I like to work. I like to make music. But it's usually with other people now. You know, it's usually just odd things.
Tot een van die losse projecten behoort in 88 het concert voor Nelson Mandela. Voor die gelegenheid komt Dire Straits nog één keer bij elkaar. Aangevuld met Knopfler's vriend en collega Eric Clapton, die aan het concert zijn hit Wonderful Tonight dankt.
But it really is unsettling, and also if you're used to observing life from the point of view of anonymity, if you like, it's harder. I mean, if you're getting a lot of your songs from just being able to walk around and be in pubs and cafes and places, it gets slightly different when you recognize more. So your standpoint changes to a certain extent. And I don't want ever to be in a situation where I'm too separated from ordinary life. That's where the greatness is, you know, that's where the joy of life is in ordinary life. You know, it's not in lifestyles of the rich and famous.